It's just after 9 p.m. in Alice Springs. The rains have cleared, the police are out, and so are the kids. Have you seen much of the violence that's been going on?
Yeah, crazy. Too much kids, you know? Running amok, stealing cars.
For all the headlines Alice Springs is generating, the police reckon it's between 60 to 80 kids that are at the centre of all of this and causing all of the problems. Sometimes that number... G'day, guys. How you going?
How you going?
I'm good. Are you all right?
Yeah.
You heading home anytime soon?
Yeah.
What are you guys doing out?
Hanging out.
In the last year, property offences in Alice Springs have increased by almost 60%. Assaults are up almost 40%, and domestic violence has doubled.
We can't continue to have people scared in their own houses. They're leaving in droves. They've had enough. Alice Springs is such this amazing community spirit, and that's why people love it here. But right now, it's getting too difficult, and people don't want to feel like a prisoner in their own home.
The mayor, Matt Patterson, is among those calling for a stronger response.
We can curb alcohol, and we've seen that with the restrictions that have been put in place, but that's not going to get 200 kids off the street. And the reality is that the kids are on the street because it's safer for them to be on the street than at home.
While alcohol doesn't explain all of the dynamics at play in Alice right now, it is a big part of the story. Youth workers Sandy and Tyler have seen the violence in videos on social media, but they also see the kids of Alice Springs up close every day.
I've been living here like my whole life and I haven't seen anything like this get to this sort of level, so I feel like it's gone pretty bad.
So what do you see as the solution here?
I reckon try to keep them kids off the street and stay home with their parents and then get them to school.
Part of the problem is alcohol at home. What do you do about that?
Yeah, that's beyond me, I feel like. I don't know.
Since the Howard government's controversial intervention, there's effectively been 15 years of grog bans for Indigenous people in and around Alice. The NT government allowed the subsequent Stronger Futures laws to lapse last July. Some were drawn to town by the grog, others to access essential services, and many of the kids are ending up in the CBD at night, escaping the alcohol in overcrowded town camps in favour of their friends and free Wi-Fi.
Alcohol is a problem, so I think whilst we put this blanket ban in for 3 months for Monday, Tuesdays, that we need to talk about putting back Stronger Futures back into the town camps. It worked. It might be an unpopular decision, but it worked.
Alice Springs business owners called a town meeting this week and we arrived at a convention centre overflowing with people and opinions.
Why are there so many people here tonight?
Probably because it's got so out of hand. Yeah, probably because there's so much crime, everybody's been affected somehow, whether they've been assaulted, broken into, car stolen.
I know what the answer is, but a lot of political correct people won't like the answer.
What's that?
Unfortunately, tough justice. Hand them over to the elders, the old elders who used to deal with them, and let them deal with them in their own way. It's what they respond to. They don't respond to our justice.
Every one of you are in this room because we're all a part of Alice Springs and we deserve a better run from our government.
This meeting discusses suing the NT government for $1.5 billion. Not everyone here is on board with that. And there's a suggestion from the stage that if you see an Aboriginal kid on the streets, call the police. This woman believes the police can help get the kids back on track.
The moment that I yelled out was in response to when the speaker asserted that any time that anyone sees kids on the street outside of school hours, they should call the police. And I actually think that's a very dangerous thing to be asserting.
We don't back supporting more child removals. Kids are removed at a higher rate than ever at the moment, Aboriginal kids, and it doesn't help.
I don't think I've seen your faces around before. We deal with this for day in and day out.
We live here too.
Kids can't even ride their bikes to the skate park. Of course I know whose land it is, but it's about becoming one and becoming together. Why does it always have to be about race?
The turnout is around 2,500 people. Just over 80% of Alice is non-Indigenous, but there's only a handful of Indigenous people here.
So you're Arunta people?
Yes, we're Central Arunta. We're born and bred here. We're not going to leave.
Yeah. One of the blokes up the back of the room who says he's Arunta says this is racist.
No.
That this is colonialism.
This is not. Whoever it is, I don't know. Not us.
And what do you see the problem as being?
Well, neglect. I mean, those kids that are breaking, they're all educated kids. They know what's right from wrong, but they just got freedom of everything, eh? I'll stand up and argue with them. You know, I'm scared, but I know that they won't do anything to me because I'll turn around and whack them myself.
So why didn't more Aboriginal leaders go to this meeting?
I wasn't even invited. Too scary to be able to go up there on the stage and say, look, I'm by myself. They probably would have said, what are you doing about it? That's why I didn't want to go. I wasn't prepared for that.
Benedict Stevens is an elder and president of the Hidden Valley Town Camp, one of the 17 impoverished Aboriginal communities around Alice Springs. You don't need statistics to demonstrate the levels of poverty here in communities at the heart of one of the richest nations on earth. But is it fair to impose laws banning alcohol targeting these communities specifically?
Do you feel the laws are racist?
There's a lot here. Not only here though, but all around the nation, yeah. But that's gotta stop. We need to live together because Australia is our home, yeah.
It is true that domestic violence is rife here. In remote areas, Indigenous women are 51 times as likely to be hospitalised due to assault as non-Indigenous women living in the same region. It's these sorts of statistics that have been used to justify Australia's long history of taking rights, choice, and even children away from Aboriginals. Meanwhile, Donna Archie fears for her safety after two break-ins.
I was on my own, but I had my son-in-law and my daughter's beautiful Alsatian. And I have said that if it wasn't for him, I'd hate to think what would have happened because the window was smashed and they were just screaming at me for alcohol.
Donna is head of the local Indigenous Health Service.
I've never felt so unsafe and frightened in the 36 years that I've lived in Alice Springs.
Is alcohol the problem? Is it the cause of the problem or is it a symptom of the problem?
Alcohol at this particular point is a cause. So we've got to treat it as a cause, not a symptom.
But if you're watching this from afar, maybe another country, and you see us putting in place policies that target one particular skin colour, living in one particular place, doesn't that just look racist?
I think it's positive discrimination. If you have broad majority community support, and the actual measure itself has significant benefit, then it actually can stand the test of a legal challenge.
We'll know this week what additional measures will be imposed in the NT, and then later this year, Australia will decide whether to enshrine in the Constitution the right of First Nations people to have a direct say in exactly these sort of decisions.
Something that was explained to me while we were there this week was that many of the kids and teenagers on the street right now have been born in the time since that intervention in 2007. Mm. And since then, rights have been taken away from the Indigenous community in this part of Australia. And it was until July last year that those, you know, very harsh restrictions on the way people could live and spend their money and choose what to do with their own funds were just removed. And so the idea that you could remove all of those rules and regulations and expect that there's no shift as a result of that, I think puts some of what's happening now into context. Mm. It doesn't explain it, it doesn't justify it, all the rest of it. But if you put very tight controls on a community and you remove them, there will be a reaction.
Mm. Especially because autonomy is a huge part of how you feel as a person, having control over your own life. That's not just, oh, great, now I can do what I want. That does a whole lot of psychological things to a human being that are really difficult to unpack. Mm. There's, like, no one way to fix this problem when there's so much deep-rooted pain. Mm. You know, how do you turn that around?
I think every time someone raises a suggestion there or from afar about this, It may seem like the simple or obvious solution, but every single option has a past and has baggage, and everyone living there feels that in some way themselves.